This is the Wilmot Historical Society gathered at Chuck and Jackie Thompson's home on Cross Hill Road on Thursday, October 29th. And we are going to ask Chuck to tell us about his professional life.
Let's see, we started in 1966, graduating from UNH, I guess is a good place to start. I had a bachelor's degree in forestry, but I had also enrolled in ROTC and had been ordered to Fort Belvoir, Virginia for engineer officer basic course training. And we spent a year there in Virginia. I was assigned as a commander of a student engineer company and went from there to Vietnam the following year and spent a year there with the 26th Engineer Battalion up in Chu Lai, which is in what they call I Corps, just south of Da Nang, in support of the Americal Division. I was a platoon leader with all the usual platoon leader assignments of building and blowing up roads, buildings, and so forth, but also destroying tunnels and running a small quarry and supporting the brigade in its transportation needs by clearing mines out of roads. So I did that for 6 months, and I've concluded that that's the best job in the Army. But after that, in November, I became executive officer of the company and was in charge of the supply and support of logistics at our base in Chu Lai, supporting the rest of the company up north and out west. And then in April of 1968, I became commander of the company, and we worked out of Camp Evans, which was north and west of Hue, and in and around below the DMZ, supporting the 1st Cav Division in their operations. So I came home in June of 68, and later that summer I was assigned to the 368th Engineer Battalion Reserves, which happened to be headquartered in Concord, now in Manchester. And I was reassigned again as a platoon leader, which I enjoyed a lot. And one of the jobs we had was to work on the ball field and the beach, which is now the Wilmot Community Association, the town of Wilmot Beach on Shandaken Road. And we brought our heavy equipment out there and cleared the land and filled the land and made a beach out of it. And then we did the surveying and basic leveling and ground grading at what is now the ball field. The grade had to come down quite a bit from where the road was. And so the bulldozers and loaders and so forth and the graders we had worked well with that. So I retired with 22 years of service. No regrets. Great experience, a few medals, came home alive, all my limbs, so that was good. Met some great people, had some great experiences. I went to work for the Department of Transportation in 1968 as a right-of-way appraiser, you know, trainee status. I went off to school for 2 summers with the Appraisal Institute to learn the trade of appraising for right-of-way, which is rather complicated. That we were building the turnpike system in New Hampshire, and the state was buying a lot of land for right-of-way work for the highways and some secondary roads. After 3 years, was hired by John Hyde of Hyde Associates as a fee appraiser and continued the same kind of work throughout New Hampshire. He and I became partners. Then he retired and I didn't. I had a business of between 7 and 10 employees. We did a variety of appraisal work all over New England. The state of Montana was a client. We did work for FDIC, review work up and down the East Coast. The forestry background stood me very well. We did a lot of industrial forestry, forest appraisal work for pension funds that had pension funds for different retirement systems around the United States, teachers' pension funds and firemen, Texas firemen and so forth. Jackie and I were married in 1965. Okay. We met in college our freshman year, and we were married in 65. And she stayed with her parents while I was in Vietnam. And we moved to Pembroke when I went to work for the Highway Department and lived there for about 30 years in 2 different houses. We had 3 girls. all of whom now are married and live elsewhere in the country. Kristen and Ryan and our oldest grandchildren live in North Carolina, and Amy and her husband and Tyler live in Salt Lake City in the ski country, and Sue lives with her two children in Sheffield, Connecticut. This coronavirus thing has really kept us from seeing loved ones. It's been a chore. So in 2002, I became very ill and had to close my business and gave it to my employees, and they've done very well. I'm happy to say they've thrived with it. But I was able to become cured of my problem at Cleveland Clinic and came back and continued some consulting work on my own for another 2 or 3 years. We built our house here in Wilmot. It was completed in 2004 and moved here at that time. Also that year, I was asked to join a lawyer from Concord in a teaching assignment in Vologda, Russia. And we went over there for 10 days speaking to municipal employees about various things that happen in democracy. It was about 100 people in the class. Back here in civilian life, I was busy, active with the town of Pembroke with the building committee and some other things. And we moved to Wilmot, and I became a selectman for 4 years and then moderator for 11, I guess, and was on the building committee for the highway garage and do some other things. Active in church up at St. Andrews in New London, active with the Forest Society. I've been on the Land Protection Committee for about 25 years there, singing in the Kearsarge Chorale and the Plymouth Summer Music Festival up at Plymouth State College. We came back here because even though we lived in Pembroke, I kept a strong interest in Wilmot. We were never that far away. Our parents lived here on Cross Hill at the family farm, and I came back often. And after my father died, we visited with my mother quite a bit and took care of some things for her. So there was always an attraction to come back here. And as a child, the land just became part of me. My wife asked me if I ever got lost when I was out in the woods, and I thought, no, I never did. It's just, I always knew where I was and where things were and so forth. I'm glad that the entire family, my sister's children and our children and she and I, agreed on putting a conservation easement on the property on the 200 acres, so that will not be developed and it will remain as it has been since our great-great-grandfather bought it in 1800. So it's sort of a legacy for our family, but also for the town. It's a nice road coming up Cross Hill Road in the fall. It's like driving up through a golden tunnel with all the maple trees, the leaves over the top. So it's been wonderful to come back to do that.
A very interesting life. I graduated from Andover High School in 1958. Most of the kids from Wilmot went to Andover for high school. I originally wanted to be a flight attendant. Stewardess in those days. But you could not be taller than 5'6" and you had to be a nurse. I had gotten to be 5'7" So therefore, I decided to become a nurse anyhow. I was accepted at Boston University School of Nursing. Attended there for 2 years. Now that I am not really totally prepared for large university life, met a sailor in Boston, with the Fort Old Ironside, and decided that I needed to go and see the world. So we got married in July of 1960. Never did get to see all of the world. I saw a little bit more. We went aboard a ship. I came back here to stay with my parents for a while. Had my son at Norman Hospital, delivered by Dr. Bill Fox, who also delivered me. And then moved to Ohio, where my husband's family was. His name is Bill Hamilton. Spent some time visiting them there, and then moved to their first vacation for a few years to become a governor. From Lakeland, New Jersey, we moved to Brunswick, Maine, where my daughter was born. And I worked as a nurse's aide in a hospital up there. I worked at the sales school and a bakery in Lakeland, New Jersey. We got transferred from Brunswick, Maine to Norfolk, Virginia, where we spent 2 years, then went to Washington, D.C., where we spent 2 more years. In Washington, we got orders to go to Albany, Georgia. A year or so later, I met a policeman in Albany, Georgia, and we got married. He was not satisfied with the law enforcement situation in Albany, Georgia. Applied to Florida Highway Patrol, and we moved to Miami. I went to, however, while I was in Georgia, I went back to school and finished my nurse's training. I worked as a nurse in a hospital in Georgia. As soon as I got to school, Miami, Florida, I went to work at South Miami Hospital in the operating room. I dearly loved surgery, and orthopedic surgery was my forte. Nuts and bolts and hammers and screws and nails are my thing. I really enjoyed it. Eventually, I got into administration there, working in inventory, and found that the politics of working in a small space like that was just more than I could handle. I left nursing, decided to try to do what I wanted to do when I was 5 years old, in West Andover, visiting my grandmother, Fittimore, over there. The milk trucks went up and down Route 4 from northern New Hampshire to Boston hauling milk. I always wanted to get on one of those trucks and go. So then I decided that I just had to get out of nursing to save my sanity. I decided to become a truck driver. I went to truck driving school in Miami with seven young guys, and I learned to drive a big truck. They didn't cut me any slack. I always had trouble backing up, but I generally was able to get by enough to get my license. And I went to work first hauling milk in Florida, from the farms in Central Florida down to the processing plants in the Miami-Fort Lauderdale area. During this time frame, I found that that husband, the cop, and I were no longer happy together. So we separated, got a divorce, and in 1985, when I really wanted to go and see the country, teamed up with a driver who had his own truck by the name of Ray Kirby, and we started driving cross-country. We worked for General Freight Company for a short time, went back into the haul mill for a little while, went back out on the road, hauling explosives for the government for a company out of South Point, Ohio. We did leave for about 2 years and worked for a company out of Knoxville, Tennessee, hauling radioactive waste. That was not really a comfortable job. We went back to hauling explosives and did that until about 5 years ago. In 1999, I started coming back here in the summertime to work as a nurse at New London Hospital and get back into operating room, and really enjoyed it as always. So I was summertime to nurse, wintertime to truck driver, and then about 5 years ago, with aging and changes in the trucking industry, it was time to leave it. And so we came up here, moved up here permanently. I have continued to, with some of my nursing jobs, I've worked for home care and visiting nurses. I've worked in a couple of long-term care facilities over the years, and I've done some private duty of various sorts. I still do that. I still miss truck driving. I miss over the road, but I don't miss the hassles of it. But I'm very happy to be back here. I saw many, many beautiful places as I traveled. I've been in all 48 states, Canada, and Mexico. But the roots were always right here in Wilmot.
Chuck, it was fun hearing that you had this strong desire to come back to Wilmot for the last half of your life. And Liz, you were gone a long time. What drew you back to Wilmot?
Some of the same reasons that my brother did. I was noticing that he followed very much in family tradition, followed his own path, but family tradition included the fact that our great-grandfather was a selectman and a moderator of Wilmot. Our grandfather was a moderator of Wilmot. Our great-grandmother was representative to the state legislature in 1925. So there was always a lot of civic involvement in our history. We read our grandfather's diaries, and he apparently had a beautiful singing voice. He mentioned he was singing at funerals. And our grandmother Thompson was apparently a pianist. We've seen her notes and some of her music books and so forth. So I think we inherited a lot of these things that made us what we are today. I believe that my chemistry is attached to this land. My eyes want to see mountains and trees, need to see them, are fulfilled when I do see them and are a part of them. I think the best smell in the world is underneath a pine tree on a very, very hot summer day when the sun just draws out the fragrance of the pine needles. The taste of sap right after it comes out of a maple tree before it's boiled into syrup, but then the syrup is just
in our sugar house down here.
And he has also continued with family tradition in that he has built a sugar house. All of the ancestors had a sugar house. There was one down in the woods further down. As kids, we spent many hours hauling sap in buckets by hand from a tree to the arch to the boiler. And he has improved it with modern conveniences and now has the tubing.
Yeah.
And makes some excellent syrup. I'll vouch for that every year. So all of these different aspects of our being, I think, drew us back and drew me back. I've been in all 48 states, Mexico and Canada. I've seen sunrise in the rearview mirror going across New Mexico is absolutely beautiful. The sunsets over the mountains, over the Rockies. I've seen some absolutely tremendously beautiful things and some very, very hard things, some hard weather, hurricanes, results of tornadoes, the whole gamut of what's available in the rest of our country. But this is where home is, and I think that it's these things that make it home. So that's why I'm here.
On behalf of the Wilmot Historical Society, I would like to thank you, Liz and Chuck, for sharing your life stories with us over these past few days. We have enjoyed ourselves immensely. Judy Hauck has been our videographer. Fred Ögmundson has come occasionally and been part of the interviewing process. Catherine Stearns, our vice president at the Historical Society, is also an amateur Wilmot historian. And myself, Lindy Heim, sometimes part of the interview process, all had a wonderful time hearing your stories. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.